The Whispering Man by Henry Kitchell Webster. Chapter 1. Not in the Papers. It is strange that we should have been talking about Dr. Marshall that very night, I and my new friend and neighbor, across our little table in the restaurant. Talking about him we were, and at considerable length, too, before I bought the paper that had the news of his death in it. But after all, it had come about naturally enough. Jeffrey and I had made friends, I think, for the simple reason that we were about as unlike as any two moderately intelligent and successful young men could be. Well, there's no use in stretching my own modesty to cover Jeffrey's position, too. He, at least, was more than moderately successful in his vocation, which was that of a painter. As to intelligence, it was a discussion of that very subject which had led to the introduction of Dr. Marshall's name. Arthur Jeffrey was an illustrious monument to the deceitfulness of appearances. He looked like a rising young stockbroker. Except among people whom he could really call his friends, he made no impression, and aimed to make none, except that of a brisk, alert, well-mannered, perfectly dressed young man, whose habitat for 7 hours of the day was, no doubt, somewhere below Chambers Street. I think it would have been hard to induce the desk clerk at the fashionable apartment building off Madison Square, where we both lived, to believe that Jeffrey, when he emerged from the elevator so promptly at 8:30 every morning, went uptown instead of down to a big barn-like studio where he painted pictures whose queerness and daring were making him the talk of New York. But if he was all commonplace on the outside, he was pure genius within. I have never known a man who as deliberately and consciously abandoned the faculties of logic and reason, which he nevertheless possessed in a high degree, in favor of the more hazardous flight of fancy. I suppose it was because he discovered no streak at all of genius in me that he took a fancy to me. What reputation I may have attained for myself as a lawyer and as the author of a large calf-bound textbook on evidence has come to me through the exercise of the very faculty to which my friend was fond of alluding in terms of such contempt, the faculty of thinking straight and consecutively. It seems he had heard, possibly from myself, although I am inclined to doubt it, of this textbook of mine on evidence, and some unaccountable freak had induced him to buy and read it. During the hour we had sat there over our dinner, he had amused himself and me by attacking, with a wealth of audacious paradox, one after another of the principles of evidence which my book contained. They were not, for the most part, principles which I had formulated myself. Many of them were as old as the common law, but the most venerable of them all was none the safer, on that account, from my friend's attack. "What does the best evidence in the world amount to, anyway, when it comes to that?" he concluded. "It's utterly meaningless, except when it's tied on behind some theory, like the tail on a kite. As for expert testimony, there's only one kind of true expert, and he is just an inspired guesser, no more, no less." "Come," said I, "take for instance Dr. Roscoe Marshall, who is perhaps the leading alienist in the United States. He has probably taken the stand as an expert in more insanity cases than any other man. Well, go and buy his book and read it, his book on mental and nervous diseases. You'll find it more interesting than mine, and see how much guesswork you think there is about that. Why, what's the matter with you? What are you chuckling about?" For my friend sat there, enjoying a silent laugh all to himself, as if what I had just said had been something exquisitely amusing. "Drew," he said at last, "never argue with a man who always has the luck on his side. You are delivered straight into my hands by your own illustration." "I don't see how," said I. "No, but you will. Listen, I painted a portrait of Mrs. Marshall this spring. She's a great beauty, by the way. She must be at least 25 years younger than her husband. Did you ever see her?" "Yes," said I. "I know her rather well. She's his second wife." "Well, that has nothing to do with the point. Marshall liked the picture a lot, so much that he offered to pay me more than the price I had agreed to paint it for. Of course, I wouldn't take that, but I asked him a favor instead. I wanted some casts made of his hands. He has the finest hands I ever saw." He finally assented, and I've got them up at the studio now. I'll show them to you sometime. Well, that has nothing to do with the point either. The advantage of not pretending to be logical is that you can wander around as much as you like. Anyway, that's how it happens that I was talking to this famous expert of yours only this morning. I had happened to tell him once that I believed that I always knew a criminal when I saw one, without knowing how or why, by just looking at him. He didn't scout that theory as you would if I were to give you the chance. He said he would recognize an insane man in the same way. He said that only the other day a man came into his office to consult him about some little nervous affection he had. The man's manner was quiet, composed, to the normal eye perfectly normal, but he knew, just by looking at him, that the man was mad, mad as a March hare. In a year or less he was willing to stake his professional reputation. That man would turn into an out-and-out lunatic. The queer part of it was, he said, this patient was a doctor himself, and he obviously never dreamed of his condition. "That's a rather grisly idea," I commented. "But that's what you say about yourself, that you can spot a criminal in the same way, just by looking at him." "Oh, I shan't attempt to make you believe it," said Jeffrey easily. "Yet if it weren't against my principles, I could offer some evidence to prove it." "Waive the principles without prejudice," said I, "and give me an instance." "Did you know that I was once a newspaper artist?" he asked me. "Of course I came out strong at murder trials in such places where the staff photographers couldn't get in. In that famous Marshbanks trial, do you remember it? I attended every session of court, and I knew who the real criminal was from the first moment. If I had been the judge, instead of bothering to select a jury composed of the 12 stupidest men in the city, I should simply have pointed out the respectable gentleman who was the star witness for the state, and said, 'Take him out and electrocute him,' and that would have been the end of it. It wouldn't have taken 10 minutes. It came to the same thing in the end, but it took 2 years to do it, and wrecked an innocent man's life in the bargain." "And you believed all the while," I repeated incredulously, "that McWilliams was the man?" "Not believed, knew. Oh, I don't know how. That's the whole point. That's what I've been preaching all the evening. The only certain knowledge is the inspired guess." There wasn't much room for argument with a man who took that position, and I was glad when the arrival of a small newsboy, crying the 8 o'clock extras in the street outside, afforded an opportunity to change the subject. It was a warm evening toward the latter part of May, and the doors were open, so I called him in. "We'll get down to something important," I explained as I did so. "We'll see how the baseball games come out." But the black headlines that caught my eye had nothing to do with our great national game. I was conscious while I stared at them of a queer sensation that might almost be called a presentiment. "That's rather curious, considering," said I, handing the paper over to him, for the item of news I had read there, which tried to make up by the size and blackness of its type for the meagerness of detail which it afforded, was that Dr. Roscoe Marshall, the famous alienist and specialist in nervous diseases, had been found dead in his office chair at 12:30 that afternoon. We made some pretense at reading the rest of the news and talking about indifferent subjects, but neither my mind nor his succeeded in getting very far away from the main theme. Finally, after a little silence, I remarked, "There is this to be said of him. He was absolutely on the square. Nobody in the world had money enough to get him to cut an opinion to fit the brief. There are precious few experts who won't do that. The state attorney's office will miss him." "Well," said Jeffrey, "I am glad I've got those casts of his hands. They are both distinguished, the right and the left one. I never saw such a pair." It occurred to both of us, I think, that we were treating the memory of an illustrious citizen rather inadequately. "Of course," said Jeffrey, "I knew him very little. You knew him rather well, didn't you?" "On the contrary, not well at all. I know her, knew her, I should say, as I've hardly seen her since she married him. I knew her rather well." "In other words," said Jeffrey, "you were once in love with her. Well, that's natural enough." It was natural enough. I think that all the men who ever enjoyed the privilege of knowing Madeline Cartwright well were more or less in love with her, and I had been no exception to the rule. The rule which I was an exception to was that the men who fell in love with her generally got over it when they found that their feelings toward her were not reciprocated. I was in the habit of assuring myself with a good deal more confidence than I actually felt that I had got over it too, but I had never gone so far as to be able to imagine for one moment that I was in love with anybody else. At all events, I had made small progress toward carrying out her injunctions of a half a dozen years ago that I go away and forget about her. She had said it in perfectly good faith, but she had said other things on that memorable night that would have made forgetting impossible to any but a man of brass. "We don't miss it by very much, Cliff," she had said. "I have hoped to come to feel toward you the way you feel toward me. I'd like to if I could, and I have, well, kept you along in the hope that I might. But it's no use. We don't miss by so very much, but we do miss somehow. Some day a man may ask me whom there is no question about. I don't know if there is such a man in the world or not, but if there isn't, I shall never marry Cliff." Well, I wish to heaven she had kept to that resolution. After that, I had pretended to her, and to myself as well, that my feeling toward her had cooled down into the comfortable sort of affectionate regard which she felt for me. I think my pretense deceived her, though it never was very successful in deceiving myself. It was about 2 years ago now that she had confided to me that she thought of marrying Dr. Marshall, and had asked me what I thought of him. Of course, I had not committed myself on a dangerous subject like that, but she had no difficulty in seeing, I imagine, that I regarded it as a mistake. So it was altogether natural that, when she went ahead and did it anyway, our relationship should have lapsed. Of course, I said nothing of all this to Jeffrey, but I did not deny the validity of the guess he had hazarded. "I would like to know what you thought of him," said I, "or rather, what you thought of them together." He was ready enough to talk at all events. "Take it all together, I think she's in luck. They were a queerly matched couple. Oh, disparity of years had nothing to do with it. They fascinated each other about equally. But while he was really in love with her, as well as he knew how to be, and no man could be with her every day and not be that, I think that in the core of her heart, she hated him." "Hated?" I cried in protest. "Come, trot mild." "Not a bit of it," he resumed. "Marshall was a queer mixture." "He was a cold sort of fish," I admitted, "but not like the other cold fishes. Most people are cold just because they can't understand. Understanding, sympathetic people are nearly always warm-hearted. If you can really stand in another man's shoes and see how the world looks to him, it generally makes you like him. But it didn't have that effect on the doctor. He saw through everybody, knew why they laughed at this and cried at that, knew how the world must look to them, but that knowledge never warmed him up a bit. Human souls were just so many specimens to him, possessed of more or less scientific interest. His wife's was the most interesting one of his collection, but that's all it came to. Why, of course, she hated him." Somewhere along in this conversation we had left the restaurant and started strolling across the square toward the Atlas, where our apartments were. Its brilliantly lighted entrance was now in plain view. In the full light of one of the great ornamental outside lamps, we could see two persons in apparently earnest conversation. One was the hall boy. You could tell him, even at this distance, by the glitter of his cut steel buttons. The other figure looked familiar, too, though I probably should not have recognized it had it not been for the present theme of our conversation. I quickened my pace a little. "Do you know," said I to my companion, "I believe that's his son there now."
"Marshall's? What's he doing here?"
"I can't imagine, unless he's come to see me. He's been attending a course of evening lectures I give at the law school, and I've come to know him pretty well in the course of the last few months. He'll take this hard, I suspect, harder than anybody else. Come, they'll have told him I'm not there, and I'm afraid he won't wait. Do you mind hurrying a little?" But the figure had disappeared in the dark before we had come near enough to attract his attention. "Too bad you wasn't a minute sooner, sir," said the hall boy as we came up. "There was a gentleman here, very anxious to see you. Ah, there he comes back now." I wheeled around to confront a white-faced young man with wildly haggard eyes.
"Mr. Drew," he cried, "I've found you at last."
I grasped his hand and his shoulder at the same time to steady him.
"You needn't tell me," said I. "I've seen the papers. Do you want me? I'll do anything I can, of course."
"Yes," he said, "Mrs. Marshall does. And I do, too. She suggested sending for you. I've an electric cab here waiting. Can you come at once?"
"In 2 minutes," said I. I turned to make my excuses to Jeffrey, but found him listening in his turn to the conversation of the hall boy.
"There's a gentleman waiting for you in the reception room, sir. He's been here some time. Says you expected him."
"Send him up to my apartments," said Jeffrey. "I know who he is."
And without turning in our direction, he walked straight to the elevator. Young Marshall and I made no attempt to talk until we were rolling along uptown in the late physician's electric brougham. The relation between Marshall and me was hardly that of pupil and professor. That is a relation I like to avoid, and in this young man's case I had succeeded. We were almost like older and younger brother. I laid my hand on his shoulder.
"I know there's nothing I can say that will make it any easier."
He gave a sort of dry sob at that, and my grip on his shoulder tightened. He was shuddering all over. The impression I got was one of horror rather than of grief, somehow.
"You don't know," he said when he had commanded his voice. "It isn't in the papers, not the worst of it."
And then he turned and looked at me full in the face, and the wildness of his eyes startled me.
"It isn't in the papers yet," he repeated. "But it will be, I think. Oh, more than that, I know. My father was murdered."
End of chapter 1.